I first met our guest this evening when I was working for the Liberal Democrats in the run-up to and for a year or so after the 2005 general election. I think Norman was then on the Treasury Select Committee and annoyed greatly many other members of the Treasury Select Committee by getting far more media coverage than any other Treasury Select Committee member, whilst also having by far and away the worst attendance record of actually attending the Treasury Select Committee, showing a cunning ability to get into the media. And at that time, of course, he was defending a majority of just 483 votes in his North Norfolk constituency, but built that up into a majority of well over 10,000, allowing him to be one of the Lib Dem MPs who avoided the obliteration that affected most of the parliamentary party in the elections last May. And I think, in fact, when Norman got his biggest majority was against Ian Dale, the Conservative commentator, you might remember, who was interviewing me on LBC just over an hour and a half ago about the future of the NHS. So I know Ian's views, and I look forward to hearing Norman's as well. Last night, I think we hit a new high at the IEA in that there was a Westminster political party and we had over 66% of that party represented in this very room. That was Plaid Cymru. But owing to the Liberal Democrats' poor result at the last election, I'm delighted that this evening we can welcome 12.5% of the Liberal Democrat parliamentary party. So please join me in giving a very warm welcome to a true gent. Someone who I know thinks he's a true liberal. You can be you can decide that as the evening goes on. Please join me in welcoming the Right Honourable Norman Lamb MP. Thank you, Norman. Thanks for coming. Thank you. Norman, thank you very much for joining us. I want to talk a little bit about political history, relatively recent political history, a bit about the
issues.
You've
always been brutal.
I'm going to be brutal. He asked me earlier, what's it like? And I said, well, think of it like a one-hour-long Jeremy Paxman interview, but far, far more aggressive. a little bit about what's happened to the Liberal Democrats over recent years, not just over recent months, and a bit about where you see the party going and what you think the big issues are that that you and the Liberal Democrats should be focusing on. When you and I first met, it was sort of getting towards the high watermark of the party. I don't know whether it's a swear word in Liberal Democrat circles now, but the Orange Book had been published. A kind of new generation of Liberal MPs was coming through. The 2005 election was perhaps not quite hitting expectations, was still a big influx of Lib Dem MPs. You were involved in part on the removal of Charles Kennedy. Min Campbell becomes leader. And it seemed to me the party was putting together a more coherent and cerebral approach to policy than it had previously done. Do you think that's when the Liberal Democrats were beginning to become a plausible party of government? Do you think things were changing? You've been a member for many, many years, but was there a seriousness about the Lib Dems in sort of the early 2000s, 2005 to 2010 period that positioned the party such that they could credibly perform in government compared to, say, the old Liberals of the 1970s?
Yeah, I do think we had got together a credible platform. It wasn't necessarily always completely coherent. No party platform is, but I think it was quite impressive. I think along with that, we had quite an impressive group of people. You know, if you think about people like Vince Cable, David Laws, Danny Alexander, Ed Davey, lots of people who, and I think then in government, actually, you know, as ministers, we didn't manage to convince the public, but I think lots of Lib Dem MPs performed very well as ministers in the government.
So in terms of sort of actually entering government, or rather sort of thinking back to the 2010 election, I've sort of said it was obviously the high watermark when I was there. That's obviously not quite true. Yeah, in the 2010 election campaign, for a fleeting moment, it looked like there could be a sensational breakthrough for the Liberal Democrats. So one or two opinion polls that put the Lib Dems ahead at the height of
following the debate.
Mania, following yeah. the first debate.
Seems a long and distant memory.
Well, quite. So I mean, we'll come to sort of what went wrong, but I mean, there was even on the night of the election itself a suggestion that in terms of vote share, the Liberal Democrats might come second to Labour. As it panned out back in 2010, it sort of fell back to, you know, a bit like the SDP Liberal Alliance had done in previously, that sort of the not the high 20s, not the early 30s, which some opinion polls have suggested, but actually the party went slightly backwards in seats and got about 22%
We increased our percentage of the vote, but managed to lose seats, which ultimately was a failure of campaigning, in my view, because, I think ultimately Nick fought a very good election campaign. And we ought to have done better than we did in terms of the seats won. We lost seats to Labour, for goodness sake, at a time when Gordon Brown was extraordinarily unpopular. We lost seats to Labour, including places like Chesterfield.
But nevertheless, you get, if you like, the arithmetical fluke that Liberals must have been hoping for generations, that there's a relatively sizable Liberal bloc and a very, excuse the phrase, well-hung parliament. You know, so it wasn't as if, you know, I was interested in, if you like, at what level would the Conservatives or Labour go it alone? Yeah. But neither party was really in a position where they could form a minority government. It wasn't as if they were just one or two seats short. So suddenly the opportunity presents itself. Yeah. And not just the opportunity, but the sort of necessity to enter government. What's your recollection of those sort of days of negotiations and decision to enter coalition? And do you think now, in retrospect, the right decisions were made either for the sake of the country or indeed for the long-term sake of the party?
Well, so I think in terms of the country, there's no doubt that we did the right thing. I think there were mistakes that we made, significant mistakes that we made. But if you take the period as a whole, between 2010 and 2015, I think the country was in a better state. The deficit was stubborn in the limited extent to which it came down, but we were in a much better state than we had been in 2010. We were off the precipice. And I think we did some genuinely liberal things in government. I think we could be proud of some of the things we did. I'm particularly proud of the pupil premium, for example. But in terms of the party, you know, I mean, it almost destroyed us. And so that presents you with a real dilemma, because, you know, the destruction or the near destruction of the liberal voice in our country, I think, is a very bad thing for politics. That's what happened as a result of it. And I think the tragedy, in a way, is that any small party looking at what happened to us will think twice about going into coalition in the future. But I think, personally, coalition government is a good form of government. I think every government is a coalition in any event. I mean, the Conservative Party is an extraordinary coalition of interests. But this is much more in the open when two parties come together. And some of the things that we did happened because of coalition. I mean, we introduced the cap on care costs, now apparently abandoned. And a good move, actually, which stood the chance of leveraging in extra money into care. And I don't mean just state money, but other private money. It wouldn't have happened without there being a coalition, because the Treasury always prevails. But here there was a negotiation between two parties, and we had to get some things for the second part of the Parliament. So, you know, I think it's a good thing, but I think it's very hard to imagine any party contemplating it in the near future with the electoral system that we have.
Right, well, you say some significant mistakes were made. We've only got 45 minutes or so, but list the top three in order of significance. What were the significant mistakes made by the Liberal Democrats and Nick Clegg and their leadership?
Well, obviously, everyone always goes to tuition fees. I think our mistake was to make the pledge. And that was a massive mistake, in my view. Because given the state of public finances, and actually, you know, if you're interested in social mobility and in making a real difference in education to children's life chances in our country, it's actually much better to invest in early years and through the school system through things, mechanisms like the pupil premium, which really puts an accountability on schools on how they're using money to narrow the attainment gap. Much better to invest in that than in maintaining what actually in many ways is a middle-class subsidy in higher education. But our complete failure to get the politics right, to breach a pledge, and then our failure to explain what we were doing was pretty fatal. I don't think our prospects actually just turned on tuition fees. It became totemic, but you know we'd already seen a significant drop in our support long before that. But then the other one I would pick on myself is actually, and we'll just call it what it's become known as, the bedroom tax, because I think it's actually very unfair. And I raised concerns about it at the time, but I didn't see those through. You're busy with the things that you're dealing with, but actually the idea, I mean, I think of my own constituency of North Norfolk, and there are many people who have a spare room in their house, but who have no means of moving to somewhere smaller because there's nothing else to move to. And to take away benefit from them, I think, was wrong. So we made a mistake on
that. Let's unpack the tuition fees thing, because I think it says quite a lot about the Liberal Democrats from beginning to end, really. I mean, how do you think the Liberal Democrats ever ended up with that policy? I mean, I was always frustrated when I was working as the head of media for the Lib Dems, that the policy process whereby, I don't know what it ever is, 1,000 delegates, you know, turn up in some gigantic gymnasium and cast their votes one way or another for policies about which no doubt
you have happy memories, I'm
sure.
Yeah,
very happy memories. But I can remember not so much on tuition fees. I remember very clearly the vote on Trident, you know, an issue that people feel incredibly strongly about, in which Min Campbell, then the leader of the party, felt that his own view, for what it's worth, I'm not sure I share it, but his own view was that anything other than the renewal of Trident should be would be exposing us to huge national security risk. And he has to go and stand in front of a hall of 2,000 people. And these people put their cards in the air, and you end up with a result one way or the other. And as it happened, Campbell carried the day by, I think, 14 votes. But, you know, had 8 people in the hall voted the other way, the Liberal Democrats would have been landed with a defence policy that the leader of the party believed was a catastrophe for national security. Is this any sensible way of making policy?
Well, I know. I think the party needs quite substantial reform in terms of how we operate. If we want to be an effective campaigning party, I think we need to be much sharper and more focused. And I think there are unaccountable sort of centres of power in different places within the party. And I think, you know, I put forward the case, you know, we now rely totally on the internet. Could we not actually allow every member to vote when the moment comes, electronically? The audience or the group of people within a conference are self-selecting. We exclude every teacher because they can't be there in September. We exclude disabled people or people on low incomes. This is
or people in full-time employment.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, sometimes it may not be in your world, but sometimes you can take leave.
Sure. Well, we would never do that. The battle for free market liberalism never ends. But you're right. I mean, it's clearly the constrictions on being able to go and spend a week by the seaside in September are pretty high, yeah. Right? So that's not necessarily a representative group of the party. Do you think that Liberal Democrat policy has and is in danger of being made in virtue of, say, special pleading? Ooh, the tuition fees, that's quite a nice policy, especially for any Liberal Democrat candidate who's got a university in their seat. Ooh, lovely, you know, that's potentially another 2,000 or 3,000 votes in the bag. That might make all the difference. I think it was one of the campaign supremos at Cowley Street once said to me, the criteria for a seat that the Lib Dems could win is that we're within 8,000 votes of whoever's on top and that there's a cathedral and a university in it. It's probably no longer true of the university. But that was it sort of special pleading, or was there any sense of ideology or about this at all? Or was it just looking at kind of blocks of votes that could be moved into the yellow column?
No, I don't think it was that. I think there were lots of people in the party, including on Federal Policy Committee and so forth, who had a a sort of nostalgic attraction, and this is not without good reason. You know, I don't dismiss the view at all, but an attraction to the concept of free education. But the problem is that it ends up benefiting the middle classes substantially. And so if in a time of scarce resource where you've got to be much more disciplined about how you use public resource to achieve your objectives, and one of my objectives is to ensure that every child gets the same chance to make the very most of their talents, that's not the best way to do it.
So coalition proves very difficult for the Liberal Democrats. Do you think there could have been anything, looking back on it, that the party might have done differently? I've had this debate with Fraser Nielsen of The Spectator on, clearly it was decided to have almost all ministries would be a mixture of blue and yellow. Do you think in retrospect it would have been better to say, whatever, the health department's going to be exclusively Liberal Democrat, the transport department, the Scotland department, and say one other, and foreign affairs and other bits and bobs are going to be run by the Conservatives? Nick Clegg could have, say, been Home Secretary, a Liberal reforming Home Secretary, the man to repeal ID cards, but you kind of leave transport policy, for sake of argument, entirely to the Conservatives. Whereas it seemed to me that it was just sort of, you know, yellow-blue dilution in every department, and therefore everybody moved at the speed of the slowest.
So that might have made a difference, conceivably, but I still think ultimately, with amongst progressive voters, we would have been condemned for supping with the enemy, and it, you know, the electoral system we have, I think, sort of reinforces the tribal culture. Of course, we hadn't had a coalition in the entire post-war period, so we were going against the sort of culture, prevailing culture in this country, and so immediately, you know, in week one of the coalition, there's a great chunk of your support just immediately peels away. This is not what we voted for. And in North Norfolk, you know, I had lots of people saying to me, you kept telling us that vote Lib Dem to stop the Tories winning. And now we've got the Tories. Now, of course, what I was saying was, vote Lib Dem to stop the Tory winning in North Norfolk. But they didn't see the distinction there. And I think ultimately, I always took the view throughout the whole of the coalition, we were involved in a massive experiment about whether you could survive a coalition in the first past the post system. I think the answer is you can't. Mm-hmm. And I think interestingly, you talk about the sort of whether the Lib Dems is driven ultimately by special pleading. I mean, every party is to a degree. I mean, there's no special condemnation of us for that. But you would have a more purist, I suspect, Liberal party in a proportional system. Because people, there's a constituency of support there out in the country for a Liberal party. Mm-hmm. But of course, in North Norfolk, I have to win a majority. I have to win the most
plurality.
Votes.
Yeah.
So I have to persuade lots of people who would otherwise vote Labour or Conservative, or sometimes UKIP, to vote for me. So you have to build your own sort of unique coalition. And that sometimes conflicts with the sort of purity of your message as a party.
So it was proving tough in coalition. And of course, you'd mentioned changing the electoral system. I mean, the script was that the Liberal Democrats would grow and grow, get a decent Liberal bloc in Parliament. At some point, the, if you like, fluke of electoral arithmetic would be such that the Lib Dems would hold the balance of power. And then as night follows day, electoral reform will happen. Quite the reverse has happened.
Exactly.
There was a referendum on electoral reform, which has presumably sort of ended that issue for a generation. So devastating was the defeat.
I imagine so. I mean, you can never say never. And you know, who knows what might emerge after the 2020 election. I mean, it's very easy to make an assumption here and now that the Tories will be in power for a generation. But who knows what's going to happen in the next four-year period. We've got the potentially extraordinarily disrupting impact of the referendum, which could fracture the Conservative Party. We just don't know. So, you know, one imagines that it's off the agenda. But if parties held power post 2020 that supported it, then everything changes, of course.
In terms of the, we've had quite recently, was it just last Friday, or the Lib Dems internal report into sort of what went wrong electorally over the last few years. But is Sam Fisk in the room? Sam's got a question. I wonder if we can get a microphone to Sam there. This is about the sort of stance of the Lib Dems in the election.
Hey, Norman. Sorry to have to bring up May last year. But was Lib Dem political positioning wrong at the election, a.k.a. the sensible party of government, or should we go on for the radical outsiders feel in terms of positioning at the election?
Well, I think ultimately it was a pretty uninspiring message that we had. You know, it was sort of, we'll cut a bit less than the Tories and we'll borrow a little less than Labour. And that's not going to inspire anyone, is it, to go out and fight the election or to go out and vote for you. So I don't think we were nearly sort of sharp or distinctive enough about what actually we offered. I'm not convinced that ultimately it would have made an enormous amount of difference to the result. I think almost with the benefit of hindsight, the result was sort of almost preordained for quite a long time, for all the sort of reasons that I've been talking about. But I don't think it was a well-fought election campaign with anything like clear enough messages. And I think that, you know, I come back to this tension that you have between winning individual seats in a first-past-the-post election where you have to build up this coalition of support and having a party that has a clarity of position. But and we have to accept that tension. But nonetheless, I think if we're to be worth anything, if we're to have any purpose, we have got to be much clearer about what we stand for, and we must be, I think, overtly a liberal party.
I mean, it was one of your now former parliamentary colleagues who put it to me that he thought that the central message of the campaign was utterly feeble. That he said that essentially the Conservative Party are saying we want to move the country 10 miles to the right. The Labour Party are saying we want to move the country 10 miles to the left. We, the Liberal Democrats, are saying we don't give a damn which direction we move in, but we're only willing to move 5 miles. Was the sort of proposition to the electorate, and it sort of felt like that. All this sort of we'll make sure that we give a head to the Labour Party and a bit of a heart to the Conservative Party.
And that was, I mean, that was also insulting half of the country as well, because you were saying to any sort of potential Labour voter, we actually think that you're voting for a stupid party, or any potential Tory voter, you're voting for a mean and heartless party. So it's not the best way to win friends and influence people.
No, exactly. Or another way that one of your former parliamentary colleagues put it, when asked what if each political party was a supermarket, which supermarket would they be? And he said, well, that's actually quite an easy question. The Conservatives would be Waitrose, you know, slightly stuck up, and, you know, a little bit expensive, very middle class. The Labour Party would be Tesco.
This is a mutual, which I'm very clear, so I'd lay claim to a bit of Waitrose.
The Labour Party would be Tesco's, which is sort of, you know, pile them high, sell them cheap on sort of an industrial level. UKIP would be Lidl, no doubt about that.
I'm waiting for it.
And the Liberal Democrats would be Morrison's. And he said, there's actually nothing wrong with being Morrison's. But let's face it, nobody drives past another supermarket to get to a Morrison's. So do you think that's ultimately what the Liberal Democrats under Nick Clegg became? This rather sort of bland, centrist, you know, bunch of nice people who might temper the extremes of the other side if you see them as being extreme, but no clear, distinct vision other than being a bunch of nice guys in the middle?
Well, I think there's a risk that we became that to the public for the reasons you've rather graphically described them. I don't think it's necessarily fair to say the Lib Dems under Nick Clegg, because that sort of puts the blame firmly with him. Because actually, in some respects, in many respects, I think he, in terms of where he was at, he potentially gave the party more clarity about where it was at than sometimes we'd had in the past. But no doubt, you know, the collective efforts of the campaign operation were to leave a pretty muddled picture for the public.
And then the election itself, I mean, you say it was preordained, but were you expecting an evisceration on that level. I mean, it was, I can remember 2 weeks before the election, somebody asked me, how badly do you think the Liberal Democrats will do? And I said, I think they're going to win about 14 seats. And I was considered, that was considered to be on the extreme low end of the like predictions. It was actually ended up being nearly twice as many as the party won. Mm. So even though you could sort of, you're implying to us you could see the way that the cards were falling, did you actually think at 10 o'clock on the night of the election it was going to be as big a wipeout as it was?
With a week to go, I said to Mary, God, I think it could be less than 20. And that conflicted with what I was being told when I rang through to headquarters and talked to some of the leading people. But that's how I felt. I didn't imagine it would be as bad as that. I mean, I do think that the Tories struck extraordinarily lucky. There was a message which in itself was quite powerful about don't risk it with Ed Miliband. Because an awful lot of the public, irrespective of where he was politically, I don't think it was the fact that he was seen as left-wing. I just don't think people saw him as a prime minister and were just sort of a bit freaked out by it. And then the idea that it could be him bossed around by Nicola Sturgeon. And then, of course, to reinforce that message, as we got into the final week of polling, the polls were completely neck and neck. And I do think the polls helped to deliver the results. Mm-hmm. And irrespective of the study that was undertaken, I know that having knocked on doors throughout the campaign in North Norfolk and elsewhere, it felt very good in North Norfolk all the way through to that final week. I'd been away on the Monday of the polling week down in the southwest, came back for the Tuesday, knocked on doors all day, and looked at my data for the day, and it was just, there was a 10-point drop from the rest of the campaign. Now, of course, it could be based on the roads you've been on and so forth, but there was something happening, and I think it was people coming to that decision and they just thought, my God, I can't take that risk. Mm-hmm. And so the message was a powerful message for the Tories, reinforced massively by the circumstances.
But as it happens, whatever might have been happening on the people that you spoke to in your own constituency on a given Tuesday, I mean, actually, the national share of the vote turned out for the Liberal Democrats much in line with the opinion polls. Yep. I mean, it wasn't as if the party was at 15% in the opinion polls and suddenly got 8. I mean, it was always sort of single digits.
Absolutely,
maybe no, exactly. 10%.
You still have to, you know, build that much bigger coalition, as I said, in your own constituency. And you, even on a low vote, you can persuade people to back you. But I think that overwhelming national message, which was very powerful, destroyed any chance of that working. So I think it lowered our numbers in that final week. We were always going to do badly, but we did much worse than we expected.
And do you think, let's move on to what the future might look like in a minute, or at least the more recent past, post the election, but do you think your party has remotely come to terms with what happened to it? I mean, I've flicked through, I've not read in detail the post-mortem report by James Girling, in which quite a lot of it is, you know, the goddamn public refused to listen to us and the goddamn media refused to portray our message. They said, well, that's democracy. And do you think there's a sense yet? And I was just looking at some of the sort of, in terms of the historical nature of the figures. I mean, your party is now essentially back to where it was in 1970. You went from about 23% of the vote nationally to 8% of the vote nationally, 15% down. In comparison, in 1979, in the constituency of North Devon, the recent leader of the Liberal Party, Jeremy Thorpe, who had gone through a court case in which he had narrowly escaped being indicted for conspiracy to murder his gay lover, lost 13.5% of the vote in his seat. So it was a more brutal thrashing than even that. Do you think this has, in any way, what sort of soaked into what's left of your colleagues?
Well, of course there is an element of wanting to find others to blame. But I think there is quite a realism, you know, out there actually about how dire our situation is and how we have to rebuild the case again for why it's actually important for there to be a liberal voice in our country and in our politics. No party has a right, a God-given right, to any share of the vote, and we've got to go out and convince people that we're worth supporting.
So let's, post the election, let's sort of talk about what the Liberal Democrats might look like or what their market sort of place might be to the electorate. You ran for the leadership against Tim Farron, definitely seen as the outsider. I think to many people, you performed rather better than initial expectations. You got about 44% of the vote. Perhaps given a little longer, you might just have won it.
You're quite right there, Mark.
I was extremely disappointed because I had money on you when you were 12-1 to be the next leader of the Liberal Democrats.
So I'm so sorry to have let you down.
I should have laid off that bet.
I knew you'd have had money on something.
Well, I was also extremely disappointed because I thought what fun it would be if the leaders of the nationwide parties were Lamb for the Liberal Democrats, Fox for the Conservatives, Stephen Wolfe for the UKIP, and I guess it would have to be sort of Angela Eagle for the Labour Party, sort of menagerie of political leaders. The SNP have got this right. You've got to sound like a fish in order to be the leader of the SNP, salmon or sturgeon.
But I guess lamb against eagles and wolves and stuff would not
exactly
go down
lamb
very
against
well.
Wolf might not have made for a, or fox might not have made for a great headline in retrospect. But what do you think the substantial differences were, if any, between what you and Farron were putting forward? There's a good friend of mine, I won't name her, who'd never been a member of the party before and was one of these people who joined in the immediate aftermath of the wipeout, a kind of similar, presumably showing some sort of form of regret about what had happened. And she was on the fence about voting for you or for Tim. And on a very sort of personal level to her, I suggested that she should vote for you. And she said, well, I'd prefer Norman more on policy, but Tim would, I think, might be a bit better on television. And I said, I wouldn't worry about that. You're not going to be on television. You go for the policy. But what do you think the differences are, if you like? I appreciate it's a much diminished party, but what do you think the differences are between different views about what the Liberal Democrats and liberalism should look like?
Well, I don't really particularly want to talk for Tim. I mean, Tim has the right to make his own case, as it were. I prefer to talk about what I stand for and what I think we should be sort of focusing on. And I do think that we need to be an overtly liberal party. But I also think we have to address the issue of sort of injustice and lack of power in society. And you can't help, if you're interested in, for example, ensuring that every child gets the same chance to make the most of their talents, which I think incidentally is economically sensible because we underuse our human resources massively in this country, then you've got to be concerned about the scale of poverty in some parts of our society. And so we have to have we have to be able to address that. But I want us to focus on power, really, power to citizens. And I mean, I'm very much of the view that with freedom goes responsibility. I don't shy away from that. I think, articulating the fact that people in society have to be responsible is quite important for a liberal party. But I do think that we need to be picking up causes like the legalisation of cannabis, which we'll be discussing at our conference, and just demonstrating that we're prepared to pass policies that are liberal, but also that hopefully have some evidence to support them. That's the direction that I think. I think when we talk about power, incidentally, it's in all sorts of respects. It's powerful citizens in terms of how we deliver public services. Our public services hopelessly often just give the appearance of being bureaucracies that fail citizens too often. And I came across appalling examples as a minister of some very vulnerable people, people with learning disability, people with mental ill health, who just were confronted by a sort of faceless bureaucracy who didn't listen. And so how we give power to people in how public services work, I think redefining all of that is critically important. Power to citizens against the big sort of monopolies that exist in public or private sector, taking on the banks and the energy companies, taking a consumer's position in the economy. I think all of these things, you can build up a coherent liberal position, which could actually be quite attractive.
Okay, well, thank you for that. That's brilliantly segued into the range of contradictions that I want to bring to your attention about what your party's been saying in recent years. Well, it seems to me, if you like, to be fair about it, one area where, although I'm not saying this has much electoral traction, but one area where the Liberal Democrats have basically never wavered has been what you might call traditional civil liberties. You know, scepticism about overbearing terror laws, opposition to ID cards, retention of trial by jury. I mean, I know in government there were sort of some members of the party thought that the party in government was leaning too far, but basically the Liberal Democrats' sort of record on civil liberties is pretty clear and very liberal. In some areas, I would put to you, not so much. So if you were to look at not the Liberal Democrats' present sort of preamble and constitution, but the former Liberal parties, you know, in all spheres we put freedom first is the last line of the preamble. Liberal Democrat Conference backed the lowering of the age for access to pornography to 16 in its 2004 conference. In its 2011 conference, it voted to ban page 3. What is the consistency of message here that you think that the party's sending in terms of freedom in what you might want to call sort of anything like controversial personal spheres? Mm-hmm.
Well, I think I said earlier that we aren't always consistently liberal, but I would also make the point that I don't think we're unique in that regard. That, you know, you can point to all sorts of inconsistencies in other parties as well. That's not to make it right, and we need to make sure that. See, I think that in a way I would put it like this, that there is a substantial chunk of people in this country who are broadly liberal in their perspective, their attitudes, their philosophy, and yet they don't begin to think, many of them, most of them probably, that the Liberal Democrats is the party that represents their views. And so the challenge for us is marrying that up. We've got to represent that significant mass of liberal opinion in our country, and I don't think we do at the moment.
Right, but hang on, there is a problem for you here. I agree with you that political parties are not ideologically coherent, but you're suggesting that the unique selling proposition for the Liberal Democrats should be to be coherently liberal. It may be that there are incoherences in the Conservative Party, that there are some civil libertarians and some authoritarians, but they're fairly consistently, you know, broadly pro-business, pro-capitalism, for want of a better word. You know, there are no doubt disagreements in UKIP, but they are fairly unambiguously against the European Union and for further immigration controls. Isn't it a problem for you if you can't even make your mind up about these matters of personal freedom?
I'm not defending every vote that we've taken in conference, and I will want to use my influence to ensure that we seek to be clear about our liberal purpose, and that's why I'm presenting the motion on cannabis at the conference, and proud to do so.
I'll come to the war on drugs shortly. I mean, another example, Shadow Health Minister Sandra Gidley called for banning sunbeds for young people in 2010. In 2012, Transport Minister Norman Baker argues for a libertarian right to cycle without a helmet. Who do you think the liberal is here and who's the interventionist? I mean, do you think there needs to be a more consistent...
I don't quite know what Sandra Gidley's argument was at that point. For children and under 18s or under 16s, there is a case for protecting them if there is a health danger there. So I don't have a particular difficulty. I don't think there's necessarily an incoherence there.
But do you think on, if you like, what you might call lifestyle freedoms, smoking, drinking, gambling, riding a bicycle without a helmet, that the Liberal Democrats should seek to be more libertarian in that space, rather than on the one hand banning page 3 and on the other hand encouraging or allowing teenagers to watch porn?
I think, John Stuart Mill is quite a good guide for me. The idea that the state intervenes when the citizen does something that adversely affects another citizen, I think is quite a good guide. And when you do something yourself which doesn't have an adverse effect on other people, the state shouldn't really be interfering with you. Now, there are lots of ways in which the state does. There would be probably members of other parties that would broadly sign up to John Stuart Mill, but, you know, the existing state of our laws does not match that. But I think our party should be seeking to try and apply that principle.
And what about, you'd expect me to ask you this from the sort of IA's perspective. Do you think there are any overarching issues about the overall size of the state and its level of expenditure, which seems to sort of, you know, remorselessly, despite all of the talk of austerity, has gone up and up and up in our lifetimes, right? So the state now accounts for round about 43% or so of all spending in this country. When the coalition government was formed, it wasn't far off 50%.
Of course, there's a significant element of that, which is payment of interest on debt.
Sure. But even then, payment on debt, that's simply because we've been spending so much previously, right?
That's got ourselves into a complete mess.
Yeah. So, but is there any sort of,
There's no golden figure.
Do you have any sense at all that sort of spending 45 or 50% of GDP in the public sector is clearly way too high? I mean, I have that view, and I consider that to be a liberal view. Now, I appreciate it opens a whole range of questions about, you know, how the hell you get from 45% to 30% for sake of argument, and over what period of time, and whether you need to grandfather out certain benefits. You can't just tell 82-year-old Mrs. Miggins she ain't getting a state pension next week. I know it opens a whole range of very difficult policy challenges, but do you sort of feel anywhere in your bones that... it's too high at 43%, 44%.
Well, my starting point is that we shouldn't think that there's anything valuable in itself in taxing people. We tax only for a purpose. That must be very much our approach. I'm writing a chapter of a book actually with a Labour MP, Stephen Reid, about public services, and because we also have a massive challenge coming down the track that the ratio of people of working age to people in retirement is going to radically changing. We've been used to it being 4-1, 4 people in work to 1 person in retirement, and it will get closer to 2-1.
Mm-hmm.
Now, so under the government's own spending plans, the OBR projects that the deficit and therefore and in time the debt starts to rise again from 2020 onwards. So, any progressive has to recognise that. We can't be in denial about it. And I think there's quite an interesting challenge for every progressive party because, you know, if you think about it, in most countries, progressive parties have been in retreat. There are some exceptions to that. The Liberals in Canada are an encouraging exception to that. But I think there is a big challenge for progressive parties about how we deliver progressive policies when public finances get ever more difficult, and particularly when there is an issue about intergenerational fairness as well.
Well, I want to put it to you that the Liberal Democrats seem to have been on the sort of addicted to public spending. In nominal terms, under the last Labour government, Blair and Brown, spending on welfare doubled in nominal terms, not quite in real terms. You know, this is a colossal increase in welfare spending, absolutely massive. And yet, the Liberal Democrats don't seem to be able to find sort of any programme they want to ditch. Oh, we can't do the bedroom tax. And I appreciate all the problems with that. Oh, we've actually got to have a triple lock on state pensions to make sure that no old person ever. So, is there any £10 billion cut that you're in favour of in the welfare system?
So we tentatively moved in the direction of questioning the universality of winter fuel payments, for example, as one example, in our manifesto last time. And an enormous chunk of the welfare budget is on older people, actually. We haven't, I don't think, confronted these existential challenges that we face. I don't think any party, incidentally, has, but I don't think we have. ourselves. But I think, you know, that so I start to talk about, and we include it in this chapter that we're writing, the role of the wider community. So, you know, my real area of interest, obviously, in health and care, we have this extraordinary existential challenge about how we care for an ageing population. And I've been very clear that the state can't do it on its own. And so there has to, and of course, the extended family has been dispersed far and wide. So the community, people in communities, neighbours, have to step up to the plate. And we have to think about new ways of enabling that to happen. And of course, if government tells people to do it, they won't do it. So this has to be bottom up. But we have to start thinking afresh about these things. And we have to ourselves come up with solutions. Now, part of that is about giving power to individual citizens, because actually when you give the budget to people, they tend to spend it better than the bureaucracy does, and that's part of what we're arguing for in this chapter of the book. But we're at the start of this thinking, and this applies to every progressive party across the Western world. We have to have an answer to right-wing parties. We can't just say no, that won't win the intellectual argument.
So, but that's fascinating then. So say on, without committing you to a policy here, but just in terms of your thinking, if you were to take pensions, for example, put aside public sector pensions, I just mean the state universal pension, do you think that we should move to a system where we accept there's a certain legacy debt? You know, we can't possibly say to 82-year-old Mrs. Miggins, you know, sorry, we've run out of money, you're not getting your pension anymore, get back into the workforce. But we can say that. We can say to 43-year-old Mark Littlewood, you are no longer part of this.
He's still only 43.
43, yeah.
That's amazing. So you've been around for so much longer.
It's the smoking. Yeah. That you could say to me, well, actually, the state's not going to provide you with a pension. Or it's, you know, all right, you're 43, you've made some contribution to the system, but you're only going to get 30% of what the basic state pension is. So make your own provisions for your retirement, Mark. And presumably I would see my tax and national insurance drop as a result. Or at least I would see my national insurance pegged to and split into, if you like, my pension when I retire and the legacy debt in order to make sure that people in their 80s aren't, you know, suddenly and unfairly having their expectations shattered.
Well, given the extraordinary change that I've talked about, the demographic change, we have to think through what the implications of that are for being able to afford pension provision, and just as important, incidentally, health and care provision. And it seems a bit bizarre, actually, that in many ways, we sort of shower largesse at many older people, and yet at the same time, we manage to massively underfund the provision of social care. That's a bit irrational, actually. Now, we can argue about how we fund social care, what the mix is between state provision and other provision, but it's in a state of crisis at the same time as we're actually spending a significant amount of our public resource on older people. So, you know, we have to think through how we resolve this. That's incidentally why part of the reason why I think it's, we absolutely need a sort of new beverage report for the 21st century, because we can't sustain the NHS and the care system as we are going at the moment. We're heading for a crash and no one's yet willing to recognise it.
I'm very fond of rebutting the people of a strongly statist view who plea an aid beverage. I think, I'm not sure if
well,
it's still going.
But Beveridge isn't with them.
No, he is not with them. I think it's worth reminding those who, you know, say let's, you know, get back to Beveridge, that the Beveridge report said that welfare payments should be at subsistence level for a temporary period of time. That would be a policy and approach that would make Ian Duncan Smith look like a screaming lefty. Subsistence levels for a temporary period of time was what the welfare state should provide, and it's clearly ballooned well beyond that, and it's not an insurance
system. But he also talked about the role of citizens in society in providing care and support and so forth, so it's much more nuanced than anyone imagined. But, you know, we're still working on the basis of a model designed in 1948, And I actually strongly support the sort of equitable sense that everybody gets care when they need it, regardless of their ability to pay. I think that's an incredibly important principle. But the system will crash. That's the truth of it.
I think I've got a question from Paul Reynolds here. Is Paul Reynolds around? Paul.
What UK institutional and policy reforms do you think should be on the table in order to accelerate fiscally sustainable economic growth in the UK over the long term?
So what do you think is holding back economic growth here? I mean, this is, you know, it's not quite a silver bullet, but if, you know, if the UK was able to get into a situation where we had long-term sustainable growth rates of, say, 3.5%, 4%, rather than 1.5% to 2%, a lot of these problems, I'm not saying go away, but my God, they're mitigated. You know, you can grow your way out of debt legacy problems, you know, let alone us striving to match some of the fastest growing countries in the world, which is a bit of a cheat, because obviously it's easier to get off the floor and into being an industrialised country than it is to move from being a highly industrialised country to a yet bigger industrialised country. But do you think that a lot of the you know, policy thinking should be simply, what do we do to maximise growth? What do we do to make sure the UK grows at 4% a year, not 2% a year?
Well, we have to focus absolutely on that. And of course, productivity has...
Falling.
I mean, this is the big failure, really, of our economic policy in, for a long, sustained period of time. And no one actually has the full answer to how you resolve this. It has to, in my view, be in large part based on a high-skill economy. And I come back to the point I made earlier that actually, you know, the case for social mobility and for ensuring that every child has the chance to maximise their abilities is not just a liberal idea, but it's economically sensible because we massively underuse our human capital in this country. So I think that has to be at the heart of what we do. But we also, you know, our export performance is also very poor. And, you know, despite a lot of effort over during the coalition years and massive efforts in going out to emerging economies and trying to convince people to trade with the UK, we've stubbornly fallen short of what we aspired to.
Just want to touch on, before I move to drugs and National Health Service, which have been areas that you've been very active in and spoken out on, one area where I assume the Liberal Democrats are united, and obviously a topical area, Britain's membership of the European Union. But I suppose my question is, just how bad would the European Union need to get before you would actually oppose it? I mean, I understand in its, you know, I understand the instinctive desire to embrace a kind of internationalist, free trading, sort of cosmopolitan constitutional arrangement. But what reforms would you want out of the EU? What do you see as being wrong with it? And, you know, how much worse would it have to get before you were determined to stay up till sort of 5:30 in the morning arguing with the other 27 countries about fundamental change, as our Prime Minister claims to have done?
Well I don't, yeah, I mean, I don't think the changes that he's introduced are fundamental. I don't oppose them, but I don't think they significantly change things. But I don't know whether you remember back at all to our time together, but actually I am deeply critical of the European Union. I think the institutions have frequently driven me crazy. I don't think the members of the European Union have taken people with them on the journey. They've taken the citizens of Europe for granted too much. But I suppose, I can't remember who it was who wrote the other day, that it's when you risk losing it that you realise that it's which side of the divide you're on. And the way I've put it in the past is that I think when it comes to Europe, the Lib Dems lose their critical faculties. So in the domestic context, we spend our lives campaigning against the centralisation of power, against unaccountable power, against the lack of democracy. And then we appear to many people to be silent when those things are just as pertinent at the European level. So I want us to be the reform party, the party that is always agitating for reform, that is totally critical of the centralisation of power in the European Union. But when I ask myself the question, how best do we resolve the massive challenges that we face of terrorism, migration flows, conflict, international crime, climate change, do we do it better together despite all of those imperfections, or do we do it better on our own? I'm very clear in the answer that I come to.
Okay, there's no obvious segue from the madness of the European Union into narcotics, but let me move swiftly onto narcotics, at least a discussion, if not immediately. You've called for the legalisation, regulation and taxing of cannabis. Tell us a bit about what your thinking is here, and do you think that the time's come, both for your party, but more generally, to get us to a stage where we end the war on drugs?
So I'm proud of the fact that we are making the case for ending the war on drugs started by Richard Nixon. Mm-hmm. It's been a monumental failure, in my view, internationally. It's resulted in billions of pounds every year going to organised crime. That's a tremendous achievement. It's resulted in the criminalisation of vast numbers of particularly young people, but not exclusively. We have the rather unattractive fact that probably half of this government has taken drugs, but got away with it, whereas other citizens are criminalised, usually because they're from a different class. And then they're employment prospects are blighted. That's a wonderful success of public policy. And in terms of health, the health consequences, it's also completely failed. And the Home Office study that we initiated during the coalition demonstrates that there's no link between the toughness of your policy and reducing usage. So even if that was your only interest, it doesn't work. So for all those reasons, I think it's fiscally responsible. We would be raising tax revenues. If I was intent on buying cannabis, am I safer buying it in a regulated market or from a criminal? I don't think criminals tend to have my welfare at heart. And we know people are going to buy it and use it anyway. So, and what a ridiculous contrast in our approach to cannabis that has some risk attached to it with the stronger varieties, and our attitude towards tobacco and alcohol, where tobacco kills 100,000 people in our country every year. There's not much of a greater health risk than killing you. And of course, alcohol causes untold misery to many families across our country. So we are just in a complete mess on this issue. And so we have a role, I think, absolutely, in pointing to a more rational, more evidence-based approach that is also liberal.
And do you have any, if you like, specific policy proposals there? Do you think, for example, the United Kingdom should replicate what's been done in the state of Colorado? Do you think that you should only be able to get cannabis via a pharmacy, or do you think, unlike tobacco, they should be allowed to sponsor Formula One motor racing cars with smoke dope on the front of a Ferrari or whatever? What's the actual content of the policy? I mean, I completely share the sentiment. And in addition to that, why stop at cannabis? I mean, I would end the war on drugs in totality. I would legalise heroin. Now, you would presumably have a stricter regulatory structure around heroin than cannabis, but how far do you see the legalisation and liberalisation going for cannabis, and how swiftly would you switch it to other presently prohibited narcotics?
So, on the first issue that you raise, I think it's been fascinating what's happened in Colorado, and of course, as each model emerges, we learn lessons, and the big process that's going to start, I think, next year is Canada. This is a whole country legalising cannabis. This is quite a significant move, shifting a whole market from the criminal market into a regulated legal market. One of the things that it's that's quite clear is that it's harder to rein back freedoms once you've given them than it is to extend them. And so there are some people who take the view, start cautiously, because you're moving into new territory. We got an expert panel to look at this for us and to come up with a sort of proposed regulatory system. I haven't seen their final report yet. It's due very soon. I will be informed by what they say. There is a view by some that Colorado will allow the big corporations to just dominate completely. And that, I think, is a legitimate concern. On the other hand, is it Uruguay or Venezuela? Which is it? Uruguay. Uruguay has gone for a pretty illiberal approach where you have to register as a user. Well, we don't want any of that. Let's just get the balance right. And let's also recognise pragmatically that we're taking a significant step forward here and that we should be careful about how we do it.
But do you think there's any contradiction in, again, going to the sort of trying to work out whether the Lib Dems are liberal on these issues? On the one hand, beginning to take steps towards ending the war on drugs. What I was aiming for was an end point. I'm not sure I'd just immediately legalise heroin tomorrow. But then similarly being sort of rather illiberal on, questions of further restrictions on tobacco or further restrictions on alcohol or limiting the number of fruit machines that can be in a gambling shop. It seems actually often the pronouncements of the Liberal Democrats are to rather screw down on some lifestyle choices that are already deeply regulated, smoking, drinking, gambling, whilst simultaneously opening up the flank of liberalising drugs policy.
Well, I would say that actually we have a rather bizarre situation with the Conservative government, that they are opposed to any mechanisms to regulate effectively or use the tax system more effectively, alcohol, say, whilst at the same time being totally opposed to any change on cannabis. Now that's a complete inconsistency of approach. And I think actually, a regulated market where you recognise that products are potentially dangerous and so you seek to educate and inform people. So I think using some tax revenues to ensure that people understand the risks of various drugs, legal or illegal at the moment. But enabling people to use that substance, I think, is the right approach. And I don't think, therefore, there is an inconsistency with regulating effectively cigarettes and alcohol, whilst at the same time moving in the other direction moving in the same direction to a regulated market with cannabis.
I want to ask you a bit about the National Health Service. You've been praised about sort of drawing attention to, and I think it's fair to even to go so far as to say changing the public debate about how mental health issues are dealt with within the National Health Service and healthcare more generally. Not so much a controversial area, but a difficult area that many people find it difficult to talk about. How wedded are you to the United Kingdom's national religion of paying homage to the National Health Service in its exact present structure and decrying anyone who suggests any reform to it as a blasphemer, a non-patriot or an extreme right winger?
Well, that's why I've called for a national conversation about this in the form of a commission sitting over a time-limited period, I suggest up to a year. Let's have that discussion about what we're prepared to pay in order to ensure that we have a decent system. I think we have to absolutely focus on what the outcome is of the money we spend. Too often we are only interested in process and we're very fond of highlighting and rightly so, the Commonwealth Fund's praise for many aspects of the NHS, but we don't talk about where they found that the NHS doesn't do well comparatively on outcomes. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, what's the most important part of a health system? It's to keep people alive and to give people a good life. So in our debate on this, we have to focus on outcomes. But I...
And do you think there are
any... But I am completely unpersuaded by the argument that there's suddenly a holy grail for moving away from a predominantly tax-funded system. When I say predominantly, the bulk of our spend on health is tax-funded. There's a little bit that isn't.
Because the annoyance I've had here, I mean, it's interesting on the Commonwealth Report, which is often cited by defenders of the status quo. I was looking at this was the one that showed the NHS is absolutely marvellous, one of the best in the world. The Guardian gave coverage to this report, and without any apparent sense of irony, said that the NHS is successful at practically everything except keeping people alive, which you would have thought would have been one of the more salient tasks of a healthcare system.
Yeah, well, that's the point I made.
And do you think there are, I mean, the other annoyance I have is whenever you get into a debate, the sort of assumption made by defenders of the status quo is it's either the NHS or the American system, or indeed some myth of the American system that people are sort of bleeding to death on the side of the road because they haven't reached for their gold card to pay for the ambulance. Not true. But even then, I'm not a defender of the American system. Do you think that European countries have approached healthcare, say Holland with their reforms, the Netherlands with their reforms recently, that we could learn from?
Well, so first of all, the most shocking aspect of the American system, although it's now being reformed and there's some quite interesting things emerging in terms of accountable care organisations under the Obama reforms, but the most striking fact is that they spend more than double their share of GDP on health compared to us, and yet so many people are excluded from insurance and so only get their healthcare through emergency rooms or A&E departments. So that is a pretty failed system.
But hardly it's anybody defends the US
no,
system.
No, sure. But you said, you know, the caricature of the US system. The US system is buggered, and to use a technical phrase.
But look at that. France, Germany, Holland, these are hardly kind of...
So,
all
so
of them have better health outcomes, according to the Commonwealth Fund report, France,
yes,
Germany,
so,
and Holland.
So, Mark, you, it's a challenge in a way back to you. Germany and France, for example, spend 11% of their GDP on their health system compared to 8-point-something for us. Now, I'm not saying that just spending more delivers good results, but that there is an element of that. And you know, if you want to achieve equality for mental health, which I am completely passionate about, you do have to make an upfront investment in it. You have to pay people to provide the service, and the service isn't there at the moment for very many people.
But my reform, the
approach that I would take is to focus on changing the way in which money is spent. So, I was the first minister to introduce the legal right to a personal health budget for people who have NHS continuing care. Now, interestingly, the system is quite resistant to allowing people to exercise that right, and so we have to apply real pressure on them to give people that right that now exists in law. But I want to extend that. Substantially, I want to give people with learning disability, people with severe mental ill health, the power to control the resources that are available for their care. And indeed, you know, there was the report out the other day on maternity services. We should be looking at that because, you know, the old bureaucratic way of delivering services fails too many vulnerable people. And in a way, that's the sort of central message of the chapter I'm writing with this.
Well, on the percentage of GDP sort of spent, I mean, you're right. I think the UK is now broadly at the European average.
No, it's significantly below.
But it's definitely below equivalent GDP per capita countries,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah. And we're also projected to spend a reducing percentage of GDP on health between now and 2030.
I've got 2 points on that. One, it is extremely difficult to actually measure the precise amount, although Christian Niemitz, our poverty research fellow here, has attempted to do so, is that quite a lot of spending, I mean, I say quite a lot, you know, a measurable amount of spending in healthcare systems elsewhere are, if you like, for non-clinical activity. So if you go to a German...
Administering the insurance system.
I want a private room. I'll give you £200 for a private room. And I want a private room with Sky Sports. And I want something more expensive off the menu for my dinner. Well, you're suddenly spending £300 a night within the healthcare system, but obviously of no or incredibly limited clinical value. Watching, actually, when I watch football, my blood pressure goes up. So actually, negative clinical value.
Not as much as if you're a Norwich supporter.
Yeah, okay, no, you're right. Southampton have been doing rather better. But we don't allow those bolt-ons. So, I mean, if you're in hospital, you can't offer the NHS £200 for a private room. When I was in hospital about 10 years ago, and they came round with the bloody hospital food, which just looked disgusting, and I said, no thanks, have you got a telephone number for Pizza Hut? And they looked at me as if I was completely crazy.
Well, you were crazy to go for Pizza Hut.
You should have seen the food I was being offered. I mean, virtually anything was better. And similarly, we don't allow top-ups. So if within the rationed National Health Service, I have a condition that they're willing to treat for, say, £5,000, and there is a better treatment available for £15,000. Well, it is not open to me to make up the difference. I either have to spend all £15,000 myself or take the £5,000 NHS treatment. So that would, I would suggest to you, if we allowed these things, very swiftly see UK spending going up. At the moment, you're basically tying the hands of patients, customers, consumers, call them what you will, by not allowing them to spend money when they might want to.
Well, for me, the most important principle is the care, the access to care. I mean, you're talking about the add-ons, the luxuries of life.
Or better drugs.
But there was, I can't remember the detail of it, there was during the Labour years in government an issue about whether you could top up to pay for...
And you can't.
There was a change made at that time to allow you to do it, and I argued the case that you should be able to do that. I can't remember the details of it, I'm afraid. So... look, I think this is the sort of thing that we should be discussing when we come to hold this commission that I think absolutely has to happen. And I think, you know, the reason why I think it's so important that we do this is that partisan politics has failed to get to grips with the problem. No party had any solution for social care at the general election. The Lib Dems didn't either. Everyone was fearful of the electoral consequences, so we said nothing about it, largely. And so you need, in a way, to give the politicians the space through a process. Mm-hmm. And it happened with Adair Turner on pensions. That process worked. It delivered a result. It may be that you then have to revisit pension policy, but it delivered a significant step change. And I think you need to do the same with the health debate.
Just a quick word about the future. Well, I've got a question here from somebody called Angela Harbert.
Can't think who she is.
Good evening, Norman. I'm a Liberal Democrat, or I should say, rather, I have been a Liberal Democrat for the last 15 years. I haven't renewed my subscription, and I'm kind of reviewing the options. If it's possible, can you take your party political hat off for a second and offer me some friendly advice about which of the current parties today, a Gladstonian Liberal, I would call a proper Liberal, should join, and supplementary on the assumption that there isn't one, would you start one, please?
Well, I would say to you that if you regard yourself fundamentally as a Liberal, Angela, you should join the party that is a Liberal party. As we have discussed today, we're not necessarily consistently Liberal. But how are we to achieve a party in this country that is that represents that body of liberal opinion unless we go out and make it and build it and build a sort of liberal progressive movement of change? And, you know, my view is that, I suspect you're not, but if you were tempted by the Labour Party, I think you would find that it's pretty illiberal and it's still its extraordinary sort of focus on the doing state, the centralised doing state, makes it unattractive to you. But I would also argue very strongly that the Conservative Party, when it is confronted by difficult choices, it's profoundly illiberal in very many respects. And, you know, just to take the drugs debate, I was on some interministerial group during my time in the coalition. And even when you raise the subject for discussion and a request to look at the evidence, it was just close it down. We cannot go there, full stop. And so, you know, the Conservative Party is this extraordinary coalition of some people who are absolutely liberal and some people who are remarkably socially conservative. So I don't think you would feel comfortable in that company, Angela.
And just to finish on this, sort of, Norman, I know it's always been the sort of aim of the Liberal Democrats and before them the SDP Liberal Alliance, and before them the sort of Joe Grimmond Liberal Party to reshape British politics, break the mould, realign British politics. I was looking at Tim Montgomery's ideas about the four political tribes in British politics. He says that there are, I'm not sure I necessarily agree with him, but that these are the intellectually coherent blocks, he thinks. There are liberals, who are sort of Cameroonians to some degree, Orange Book Liberal Democrats to some degree, perhaps some Blairites, but those who are not particularly militaristic. There's a kind of solidarity socialist bloc, which is the left of the Labour Party, the SNP, those type, the Greens, I guess. There's what he calls the Nationals, which are sort of the wet patrician Tories, Christian Democrats. And then he says there's the sort of libertarian freedom group, the sort of right of the Conservative Party, but some parts of UKIP. Do you think that we're actually witnessing in politics, not just in Britain, across the Western world, if you take a look across the pond at what's happening in the US presidential election, but here too, and on mainland Europe, that party politics is now much more dividing across ideological lines, or at least from the say what you think is now popular, whether you be a lefty, a righty, or somewhere in the middle. And this sort of split the difference, none of the above, steering a centre course is becoming increasingly unlike a successful electoral strategy. And whatever you think of that, do you think there could be a realignment of the political parties along more coherent lines in British politics?
Well, you can but hope. And I, you know, I do think that this period of politics in this country is absolutely fascinating. I mean, on the one hand, you instinctively, as a Liberal Democrat, feel depressed because of the state we're in. But if you think about this Parliament and the factors and influences that are out there, it's enormously unpredictable. We've got the potential sort of exocet of the European referendum. And just, you know, to watch David Cameron stick the knife in, not once, not twice, but three times to Boris Johnson. Now, that's on the first day of the campaign. And I just think it's going to be, and on Newsnight the other night, they replayed the debate within the Labour Party. Between
Jenkins against Ben.
Yeah, exactly. And it becomes visceral. And of course, it led to the fracturing of the Labour Party. So who knows? Who knows? No one, I don't think, in this room can predict what the fallout from this process might be. And in politics, you, and in a democracy, you have to have a sort of viable alternative. If you have, you know, you're a great believer in competition. If you don't have competition in politics, you have awful, arrogant, complacent government, and I think that we're in real risk of that happening over this Parliament. So somehow we've got a progressive liberal force has got to emerge. I hope it will be centred around the Lib Dems, but it has to happen in order to ensure the sort of viability and success of our democracy.
Norman, we've been speaking for more than an hour and 20 minutes.
Bloody hell.
Thank you for your ideas. The upside here is, I do suppose for the Liberal Democrats, it is pretty hard to imagine things getting much worse. But we wish you well in promoting liberalism. We hope that the IEA and other organisations can help in forming that liberalism, or at least challenging some of the orthodoxies that are bandied around in British politics. Thanks very much for being our guest this evening. It's been a real pleasure cross-examining you, and I hope I've not lost none of the aggressiveness that you remember from back in the day. Norman Lamb, thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Thank you very much. Thank you.